So this is one, as part of our project, we are starting from inscriptions, documenting them, creating a spatial temporal visualization of the diversity of meshes. That's, as I said in the beginning, that's one part of it. The second part of it is to collect as many different texts, manuals, whatever treatises in Tamil and Malayalam, astrology, astronomy, architecture, blacksmithy, carpentry, accountant manuals, school textbooks, primers. So those are the kind of range of things that we are talking. And we came across this particular text, which Prakash and Babu will talk about, is something to do with the measurement of pearls. And because we have the southeastern coast and the southwest coast, which had a very long connection with the Arabic world and the Persian traders, as well as with the Sri Lankan coast, where the Portuguese and you know, different colonial powers starting from about the 18th century, we wanted to see where does the text exactly time-wise belong. And then these are texts written in of which Prakash will tell you more. So it's one of the interesting texts that we got, and there are several of them. And we thought we will see how to make sense of it as a measurement of pearls in South India. That's what Prakash and Babu will talk. So Prakash is also part of the project. He is in the French Institute. He's a classical Tamil scholar by training. Babu is also trained in the Tanjavur Tamil University, where Professor Subrayalu used to teach. And he also works in the French Institute, and both of them have studied the text together. They'll present. Yes, Prakash. Yeah, thanks.
Yeah, thank you. Can you hear me well?
Yes.
Yeah. So I would like to thank Roy, Babu, and Professor Subrayalu before. And I will share my screen right now so you can see. Oh, yeah. Yes. Okay. So the title is Muthukanakku. That is, I'm going to introduce this text to you all. Measuring pearl in South India. The pearl fishery coast in the Gulf of Mannar was one of the richest pearl fisheries region in the world. Monopoly of the ruling kingdom over this region allowed them to harvest the pearl oysters for centuries. That pearl fishing has been practiced for long is proved by its being mentioned in Tamil Sangam classics, which the period is between 3rd BCE to 3rd CE. Foreign notices such as Ptolemy's, the Periplus of the Erythraean Sea, and Marco Polo, and many others, and inscriptions and copper plates of Cholas, Pandyas, and Sedibadi kingdoms. The officials of British India published extensive reports on pearl fisheries in the Gulf. These reports detail the history and economic gains through pearl fisheries for the British. Marine biologist and inspector of pearl banks, James Hornell's detailed study submitted to the government of Madras in 1905 gives us a wealth of information on pearl fisheries in the Gulf. Despite the importance of pearl fisheries in the region, only a few works have been written on this subject and even fewer have been published. Muthukanakku, the subject of this paper, is one of such unpublished manuscripts which is taken into consideration in this paper. Historically, the people involved in this pearl fishing were the Parava community of Thoothukudi, a coastal region in the southern Tamil Nadu. According to some sources, this community has been pearl fishing from 600 BCE. Tamil classics such as Pattinapalai describe the bazaar where merchants sell glorious, expensive stones such as pearl, diamond, and all. The Parava community, because of their control over this precious resource, received special privileges from Pandya kingdom. Describing the power possessed by this community, James Hornell says, when the Pandya kingdom was powerful, the Paravas had grants of certain rights from the monarchy, paying tribute from the produce of the fisheries and receiving protection and immunity from taxation in the Gulf. The fishery in these early days appeared to have been extremely prosperous. Thus, in 1813-30, Friar Jordan who visited India at this time tells us that as many as 8,000 boats were employed in the pearl fisheries of Trinavelly and Ceylon. Since pearl fisheries were controlled by one community for a long period only, they must have known how to weigh and value pearls. The Arabs, the Portuguese, and the Dutch, with the special permission from the local ruler, also became involved in pearl fishery later. This book was probably written at a time when many communities required a common method for measuring and valuing pearls. It is about the introduction of manuscript and sources. There are two manuscripts available. One in the French Institute of Pondicherry, which you can see in the top one, in the top, and another in Oriental Manuscript Library, GOIML, that's in the below. The manuscript available at IFP is complete and comparatively later than the manuscript found at ORI, which is incomplete and older. This text is difficult to understand because there are no commentaries available, nor can we ask anyone, since the practice of pearl fishing stopped in the 1960s. No one who was involved in pearl fisheries alive today, hence getting details regarding the text is indeed difficult. Apart from the foreign notices and reports, S. Arunachalam's The History of the Pearl Fishery of the Tamil Coast is a pioneer work on pearl fisheries. Ms. Dekla, who has concentrated on pearl fishing by the Portuguese in Thoothukudi, has written an exceptional thesis which has not been published as a book. There are a few articles written by eminent scholars published in various journals helps us to understand the text. Kaduvathi Mohammed Lebbai's stupendous work on pearl measurement, Muthuchevu Kanakku, which was published in 1881, allows us to understand the present work much better. And you can see the first page of that Muthuchevu Kanakku, which was published in 1881. So this text, which was published in Kayalpettinum, a renowned port town. And this is an inscriptions from Chola inscription where the details on Muthu and measuring pearl have been underlined here, you can see. This is a South Indian inscription which was published in South Indian inscription in the volumes. And this is the report which has been submitted to the government of Madras by James Horner. So, introducing text, you can see here, the two manuscripts have been compared and there are differences, textual variations are there. So, those textual variations have been given on the bottom of the page. So, these are the example of the text. Muthu Kanakku was probably written by one Subramanian. The second poem in this text mentions the name of the author as Pachai Muthu Sudan Subramanian. Subramanian, son of Pachai Muthu, who belonged to the town Mandiranagar, wrote this Kanakku text. Mandiranagar was the name given to the town Thoothukudi. So, Subramanian, who belonged to the town Thoothukudi, has written this text. This text totally has 23 songs, classified under 8 sections. Chiefly, this text focuses on 3 major topics. Those are kinds of pearl colander and calculating holes in each colander. In other words, volume of the colander. Unit of measuring pearls and valuing pearl with a distinct measurement cebu. Chola inscriptions are the earliest available evidence of pearl measurements and valuing pearls. Yeah.
I miss one word. What does colander mean? I'm sorry.
No, it's colander.
I'm sorry?
It's a sieve.
Ah, yes. Okay, I understand. Okay. Thank you so much. Because without this word, I was lost for the rest of the talk. I'm sorry. I interrupted. Sorry.
Yeah. So, Chola inscriptions are the earliest available evidence of pearl measurements and valuing pearls. Rajaraja I in 1006 CE, while granting gems to the Tanjavur Bharatadeshwara temple, commonly known as Big Temple, provides information on pearls. The phrase goes thus: Muttukovalamum nirai naarkalanje ettu manjaadiyum naangu maavukku vilai kaasu 11. Rajendra I, successor of his father Rajaraja I, also granted pearls to the same temple in 1015 CE. The phrase of the inscription goes thus: Aayiram muttu pavalam nirai 77 kalanje naalu manjaadiyum kunrikku vilai kaasu 500. So these two inscriptions, while measuring the mass of gems, they follow the measurements kalanje and manjaadi. With the mass of the pearl, they have valued the price of it. So we can surmise that kalanje and manjaadi are the two units used in the ancient period where sevu was unknown. There was an agreement given by Padanan Vishayata, that is a kind of corporation of four townships, undertaking to contribute half a panam on every 100 pearls sold at Kiranakarai for meeting the requirements of worship and the repairs in the local temple. So these are the lines from South Indian inscriptions, which was given to the temple on 1537. So this clearly states that in the 16th century, the stores were established in Kiranakarai to sell pearls. Hornell, in this report, mentions sevu as one of the unique valuing pearl. The following statement of Hornell predicts that some kind of common measurement was used among people. The sailors and children bring the pearls which they have stolen, and people of every kind have bargains to offer. Persons having but a small capital buy small ventures, which they immediately sell to larger merchants with a middling profit. So we can surmise through the above argument that Muthukanakku would have returned between 16th to 18th centuries when a common measurement was in use. 3 meters were used by the author in Muthukanakku, which are Venba, Viruttam and Akavar. The first 3 invocatory verses dedicated to Lord Ganesh, which mentions the author's name as well, the verse on the pearl colander and the verse on the measurement manjaadi were written in Venba meter. The last verse, which provides details on kinds of pearls, is written in Akaval meter. So the rest of the songs are written in various kinds of Viruttam meter. So when we talk about descriptions of Muthukanakku, the aim of the text is to help the merchants to calculate the price of the pearl according to the size, kind and quality and weight. To begin with, the text gives an introduction to pearl colanders, that is Muthupetti in Tamil. There are totally 10 different kinds of colanders with different sized pearls. The size of the pearl decreases from top to bottom. The names of the colanders are in numbers 20, 30, 50, 2000. The topmost colander is 20, which has big holes. According to the text, there are 91 holes, Tamar. The text says it is Tamar in the colander. That is, in the 20, number 20, there should be 91 holes. The pearls settled in the top colander are the most expensive, big in size and of good quality. In order to measure the pearls in various sizes, they prepared this kind of colander with holes in various sizes. And you can see an example of colander which was preserved in museum with no frontiers. And these are the 2 songs given about how many holes are there and what are the names of the colanders. We could not find any pearl colanders from the Tamil Nadu coastal region at present. Museum with no frontiers preserved the colanders used in the Middle East. The pearls having been extracted from the shells and carefully washed were placed in a metal receptacle containing some 5 or 6 colanders of graduated sizes, which were fitted one into another so as to leave a space between the bottoms of every 2 and were pierced with holes of varying sizes. That which had the largest holes being the topmost colander, and that which had the smallest being the undermost. When dropped into colander number 1, all but the very finest pearls fell through into number 2, and most of them passed into numbers 3, 4 and 5. This, the smallest of all, the seeds were strained off into the receptacle at the bottom. When all had stayed in their proper colanders, they were classified and valued accordingly. This statement from Hornell helps us to understand clearly how muthupetti, that is pearl colanders, were used by the pearl merchants. It seems that the number of holes in the pearl colanders differs according to the merchant. The verses from 2 to 4 teach us how to calculate the number of holes in a colander. To do that, one has to draw axis of seed and calculate the number of holes in one axis. By then, one can easily count the number of holes in that colander. Verses 3 and 4 provide the number of holes in one axis, and verses 5 and 6 put forward the number for hole calendar. You can see in the presentation the verses 5 and 6. The number of holes in the colanders are given in the Muthukanakku are given below. So these are all the holes given according to the colander. So interestingly, no report names the colanders are mentioned in this text. They name the colanders as number 1 to 5. How can we understand this variation in practice? Why did the local merchants name these colanders in numbers? Interestingly, there are no correspondence between the name of the colander and the number of the holes. But finding the similarity would probably account for the connection between the units of measurement and the number of the holes of a colander. Let us talk about unit of measurement. Kalanju and Manjari are the two units used to measure gems from the ancient period to the recent. Inscriptions from Pallava kingdom from 8th century are the earliest available historical data on these two units of measurement. As mentioned earlier, Kalanju and Manjari were used to measure pearls by the merchant. Following the tradition, Muthukanakku also describes the method of measuring pearl using these two units. Kalanju was usually measured as 72 grain, approximately 4.66 gram, where Manjari equals to 3.6 grain, approximately 0.2332 grams. Fabricius, in his Tamil to English dictionary, recorded the value of Manjari as 4 grains. Since 20 manjari is equal to 1 kalanju, the value of this unit in grain is 80. However, it is very really difficult to find how pearls were valued through measurement as mentioned in this text Muthukanakku. Verses 8 and 9 describe the method of measuring the pearls in a colander through manjari. Pearl measurements in manjari according to the text are given below. So, number 20 colander measured as 1 manjari. Simultaneously, 30 and 50, how they have measured manjari, has been given here. Here, you can see, this text introduces one more colander numbered 1500. Which was not mentioned earlier in the appropriate words. So we don't know how many holes will be there in this colander. Probably double of the colander 1000. We have to check it. According to this list of measurement, how can we measure pearl? By colander or by number of pearl? One Chola inscription in 11th century measured 37 pearls as 8 manjari. If 37 pearls weigh 8 manjari in 11th century, then number 20 colander, which contains 91 pearls according to this text, according to Muthukanakku, that is 91 pearls, cannot weigh 1 manjari. One pearl cannot weigh 1 manjari either, since the calculation has not drastically changed from 11th to 16th century. So this is the basic problem we have. While describing the calculation in verses 10 and 11 of Kalanju, the colander was equated with a certain number of pearls. According to the text, 20 pearls in the number 20 colander is equal to 1 kalanju. The number of colander and pearls are equal up to 50 and rest change according to the calendar. You can see in the screen now. They should have used one set of calendars which should be same to all merchants to measure coal in both units. However, we can weigh in both Kalanju and Manjari by calculating the difference in number of coals. Now, we can see the statement of Hornell here, which has given in 1905 size in the basket, number, and here he mentions quantity in Cebu. Now we are going to see about this distinct unit Cebu, which was mentioned in this text, in this Muthukanak. Cebu is a unit introduced by this text, which was not seen in any inscriptions or proper place or in any reports. Miron Winslow, in his dictionary, defines Cebu as a rule in estimating the number and value of pearls, that is Muthukalin Nirayalagu in Tamil. In another definition, the same dictionary gives striteness and correctness. And there, Winslow gives an example, I bought 10 Cebu of pearls. So that is a historical phrase we get, how the merchandise have been happened there. I bought 10 Cebu of pearls from the 18th century, from the 19th century, we get this example. So following this, Tamil lexicon defines Cebu as a unit in counting pearls and gives example following Winslow, the same. Hornell, in his report, has produced a statement on pearls sold in the 19th century. Cebu was also included as a unit of measurement in his statistical table, which you can see in this screen. You can see quantity in Cebu, that is the third column. While listing the statistics of the 19th century pearl profits, he lists 10 kinds of pearls. You can see Ani, Anadari, the description, under description, you can see the list of pearls and size in the basket, 50, 20. Here is the first historical data we get with this name of the calendar in the same number. And numbers, we don't know what kind of number this number in this column refers to. And quantity in Cebu, that is the first historical data we get where the Cebu has been used to weigh the pearls. Weight in Kalanji and Manjari and value per Cebu and also per Kalanji. Quantity of the pearls has listed in one column and the value in another column per Cebu. You can see it here. Cebu was probably used to measure quality pearls in both weight and value. Cebu was measured first in Kalanji and Manjari and then pearl was valued according to it. The measurements of Cebu in Kalanji and Manjari are described in this text. You can see it here. For number 20 calendar, one Manjari, which is equal to 4/3, and for one Kalanji, the Cebu calculates 15. So you can see the measurement, weighing measurement for Cebu and Cebu, which is equal to Manjari and Kalanji, how it differs up to 1000. And interestingly, here the manuscript doesn't mention number 1500 calendar. Through this, let us try in a mathematical way. If Z is Cebu, A is number of calendar, B is the number of poles in the calendar, X is Manjari and Y is Kalanji, then we have to find Z for both X and Y. And next, just an imagination, let us do A by B into X or Y is equal to Z. To calculate the Cebu value of pole, one has to clarify the number of poles in the calendar. When we get a clear understanding of the number of poles, then Cebu is easy to calculate that we couldn't. The last verse of the text is about the kinds of poles. The author lists the good and bad poles. This list of poles corresponds to James Hornell's statement of report, which you can see it here. The same names have been given in the text. So to conclude, the aim of Muthukanakku was to standardize the pearl measurement which was used within a community in the past. Most of the calculations described in the text must have been in common usage because the author leaves the relation between the number of pearls in a colander being measured and Sevu unexplained. While measuring pearls, author measures it by colander instead of measuring by number of pearls. This creates difficulty to understand how did they measure pearls. Pearl and diamond sellers in India today follow the universal units of measure and to value pearls. They distinguish pearl into cultured and semi-cultured pearl and follow carat and gram respectively to measure gems. The ancient measurements such as Kalanjian Manjari are no longer in use. Thank you.
Yes, can you hear me?
Yeah, somewhat.
Let us try.
Okay. I couldn't clearly hear you. So sounds clear. So sorry for the disturbance here. Thank you. While reading the report submitted to the government of Madras by James Hornell, I understood that this text should be written for the people who involved in mercantiles, not for the people who died to collect pearl, and also not for the people who are not involved in this mercantile. But if you see, the people have stolen some pearls. When they usually, after collecting the pearls, they kept in an open area to dry and for three to four days. And we don't know whom have protected that area while the pearl oysters dry. So at that period, some people would have stolen, and also when the people who died, they also kept one or two oysters, according to the report of James Hornell. So in some kind of information, we can assume that the divers who collect pearls also would have known how and what kind of expensive this pearl should be. But according to me, I assume this text should be written only to the mercantile people. Arabs, Portuguese, Dutch, and also the local Parawa community, with the local rulers. Not for the people who are not involved in this trade. Hi. So this numbering number 1 to 5 given by the James Horner, the report, in the report we can only find this kind of numbering: number 1, number 2, number 3, number 2, number 4 and number 5 are given by James Horner, not by the text. We can find only number 20, 30, 50, 80, 100 and 2000. So that's the name of the calendar given in the text, in the manuscript. But number 1 to 5 is given in the report. And I think probably, yes, number 1 is the highest quality and bigger in size and expensive. And number 2, number 3 is decrease in range, in size, and also in price. I think so. I think you are right. But that numbering was not mentioned in the manuscript, that Muthukanakku manuscript. Thank you. Yeah, that's a good question. You see, apart from gold and diamond and any other gem, or any other gem, pearl is the one thing which has been considered as an expensive, one of the gems which is expensive in the world. And this pearls can get only, can harvest only in Gulf, only in Gulf areas, Gulf regions in the world. Wherever Gulf, you can also see in Bahrain and many other Gulf regions, this pearl have been harvested, this natural pearl have been harvested. And while I was talking with a gem seller in Pondicherry here, he said gem usually melts. The pure gem melts when it touches our body. Gradually melts. I think, I don't know why, maybe they said it's luck. When it melts and when it touches your body, it is luck. Or some says it is a medicine. Or some says in various reasons are there. But they say pearl, that is muthu in Tamil, it melts when it touches the body. The pure pearl. So I think they found some kind of importance, because you see, this pearl harvesting was being happened for over 2000 years. So diving, like it is a part of fisherman community. It's a part of fishing, pearl fishing, and also con. So I think there should be a belief in having this pearl, and it is expensive. It's a kind of a status. So there are many reasons we can say. Thank you. Yeah, please. That is the question same I have. Because we don't know why they have given this number to the calendar. 20 and 30, 20 to 80. I want to see you one. Just see the screen. 50, 80, 20. 20 to 80, which has been given quantity in Cebu. According to one record, this Cebu is a kind of a measurement used only for expensive pearls, not for normal pearls. You see the other pearls, very good tool, the other 100, 200, 400, reduced in size, small in size, and also small in quality. So those does not measure in Cebu. So 20 to 80 are the calendars which has the quality, high expensive quality pearls. But I don't know why they have given this number. Because there's no one here who were involved in this pearl diving or pearl fishing. They're no longer here. So that's why there's one reason. So past text here in Tamil, we don't have any past text. In Tamil text, in Tamil, this, in 1881, you have seen here Muhammad Lebai from Thoothukudi. So that is the only text we have right now. But according to, so this is the text should be earlier than this, than the published text 1881. But we don't, since we don't have any earliest text, we cannot see the historical background of the text, or but in Sanskrit we can check. We can check with Sanskrit related texts about pearls and all other. Thank you. Thank you, and thank you for that mail. You know, according to this text, Cebu, the Cebu has been calculated in only the manjari, the measurement manjari have been doubled, multiplied with square, and multiplied with the fourth quarter, fourth third of the same, and with the price which was in that day have been calculated to measure the Cebu. So that's how the Cebu has been measured according to some from Sri Lanka, as we know. So I think there are two possibilities to say from Malayalam Kanakadhikaram that according to, in order to specify an expensive qualified pearl to measure one kind, they have followed one kind of measurement to price a good pearl and another kind of measurement to price a normal pearl. Silver, it's a kind of measurement they use to price a good pearl. So I think this kind of different kind of measurement have been used. So this Kanaka Viharam would also mention that kind of measurement, I believe. I assume. And yes, probably we can say two kind of measurement would also be followed. But that should be known because this trade, pearl trade, have been followed for over 2,000 years. So this western east is, it's not too far. The landscape is more close. So that should be known each other. The measurements should be known each other. So they have to check with, historically we have to check also in Malayalam to understand this. And yeah, we both, Babu and I, thank you all. Yeah. Thank you.